Well, one challenge that they've had really before the Cahuangco family is to withdraw this case, is to show their willingness and their sincerity in saying that we will eventually redistribute this land in 5 years.
Yep,
should they not do that? Should you not call on them to do that? I mean, if it would make your job easier, right?
I'd be wearing a different hat if I responded to you.
Mm. It's like pulling teeth. But okay, here we have questions from our friends on Twitter and Facebook. Dilaw Ako asks, what is DAR's computation on tenants' allotted lot area for coconut lands, and how much land area would the tenant get on rice lands? Okay, it depends on what's planted, no?
Right.
Okay.
Well, the average size is around 1.2 hectares. Mm-hmm. For the beneficiaries.
Okay.
The maximum we can grant is three hectares.
Uh-huh. And the price?
It would range. I mean, in sugar, you would have anywhere from 180 to 200,000 per hectare in terms of compensation to the landowner.
Mm-hmm.
But the farmer pays, the landowner is paid in 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
The farmer must pay in 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And the payment he makes is based on the production that he has on the land.
Mm-hmm.
So there is an implicit subsidy
By the state,
in what the farmer pays.
Mm-hmm. And you don't see any problem in this? You don't need to eat? Well, this is what's provided by the law.
Yeah.
So what do you say based on your studies of it?
Well, you know, there's a difference between taking land away for a road and taking land away to distribute for agrarian reform.
Okay.
There's a social justice component involved here. So we put a lot of value on the production that was there before distribution.
Mm.
The theory being, if you're the landowner and you produce so much,
then you'll get more.
Mm. Then if you made the land very productive, then you'll get more because there's a capitalized net income.
Okay. So, but otherwise, you'll get less as well.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But that's where the corruption is, no? In the valuation.
Right. Well, the valuation of land is not actually done by the Department of Agrarian Reform. It's done by the land bank.
Hmm.
And if the
landowner
contests this goes before the special the adjudication board, then it goes to the special agrarian court.
Mm-hmm.
By now, after almost 20 years, there are fixed formulas on how to compute this, and there's not really much discretion on these things.
Okay, so maybe in the earlier days.
In the earlier days, you had many scams that came about on this. I imagine there's always a new court case, a novel theory that will be posited by the lawyers for this.
Okay. Joseph Pangilinan says, Carl, Carp, and Carper all seem to have been unsustainable. Can you share any successful model of land reform anywhere in the world which is doable in 6 years? Is that a correct judgment to make?
It's tough doing agrarian reform or land reform.
I know they said Taiwan. That's the secret of how Taiwan became.
Korea and Japan.
But that was what? How many decades
You have some
ago?
Models also in Latin America.
Mm.
These are all
here
done
in the Philippines. Wala.
Well, in the Philippines, what you're looking at is really the rice and corn, which was really done within 1972 to 1985.
Mm-hmm. Prior to the Korea administration.
In fact, a big portion of this hectareage that we're looking at were actually rice and corn lands, which were the subject of tenancy and distributed during the martial law years.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So then it's really a very challenging job that you have because you can't even cite a successful...
Well, there are many success stories after 1986 of agrarian reform communities who have gone on to graduate to full-fledged production units. And the common denominator is that there were support services given, there was credit support given, and there was a lot of organizing that was being done. And we can cite many stories, individual stories, that show that agrarian reform does work.
As a percentage of total land distributed, would you say it's minimal or more than half?
Let's put it this way. If you did not own the land before and you were simply paid a minimum wage, assuming this was a plantation type, and the land is covered by agrarian reform, and the land is now yours, at the very least, you will have additional income on the use of that land that was given to you. That's the least that you would have.
Well, the least. But then, of course, you want them to prosper. You want them to have wealth.
That is why the challenge in the new administration is once and for all for DAR and DA and DNR to come together and improve the income of the farmers.
So you're saying the partnership before was lacking. There was no synergy between the two.
Well, let's just say that now it's tighter. Okay. Secretary Alcala, Secretary Pahe, and I think DNR. The first week of the Aquino administration, the first thing we did was to meet and sit down together.
So it's doable in 6 years?
Well, we're actually looking at four. It's only up to 2014. So, but beyond this, I mean, the effort to increase productivity in the land does not stop. It's still a government mandate that we must fulfill.
Okay. Going back to Hacienda Luisita, we just have to wait for the court's decision before you act on it.
Right, because we are stopped by the Supreme Court from doing anything at this point.
And whatever decision the Supreme Court has, you will not contest?
It depends on what kind of decision they make. I mean, I'm sure whoever is the losing party there will have still a motion for reconsideration. It goes final, and then we have to do whatever they order us to do.
But then the president said it will be distributed, the land will be distributed. So is there any other way of interpreting that?
Well, it will really depend on what the Supreme Court says. Now, as to what he does, he is a shareholder. He is not really a landowner in the strictest sense of the word. It's something that he will have to determine.
Well, finally, do you think this is casting a shadow over, you know, what you'll do? I mean, the Hacienda Luisita issue will come up all the time.
Inevitably, it will. But our target, at least during the first year of this administration, is to be able to show success stories with the convergence of DAR, DA, and DNR to make sure and show that it does work, incomes increase with agrarian reform.
Okay, in the first year, how many hectares do you plan to give out?
From a July to July target, we hope to have around 130 to 150. I should find that, firm that up by next week. From a calendar year, January 2011 to December 2011, we hope to go back up to speed at 200.
So 200 annually will bring you to 1 million?
Yes.
Where is the Hacienda Luisita in that 5 years?
You know, the weird part is that it's already counted as an accomplishment. So even if you distribute the 4,000 hectares of Luisita, it doesn't add
even
1 hectare.
Ah, really? So from a statistical standpoint, it's not good for you. Well, but of course, that is, it would be the model of how successful you will be, I suppose. The test, the litmus test.
One of those.
What are the others?
Well, the provinces with the high balances, the provinces with the high balances of collective CLOAs, most of what they're distributing now are really sugar and coconut. And as you know, we are importing sugar. So if we are able to increase the production of sugar in agrarian reform lands, we would have increased
reduced the imports.
We're bleeding with sugar.
Okay, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, surely not enough to discuss this. So we hope to see you again.
I'm and sure you will call me again.
Well, yes.
And you're counting all the things I said I don't know. So
we gave you a pass on many questions, and well, it's been just a week, so.
Yep, it's nice to be in the hot seat for a change.
Thank you very much, Secretary.